Okay, let's begin. In the last lecture, we started Word2Vec. And Word2Vec is basically a way to represent words in some vector space such that similar words are close to each other and the similar words are far apart. And by maintaining this property, we have seen that we can apply arithmetic operation on these vectors and add one vector to another vector, subtract a vector from another vector, and somehow infer a semantic relation between words. Okay, I told you that there are two models that are known as Word2Vec. One of them is continuous bag of word. And the other one is a skip gram. In continuous bag of word, given context, we are trying to predict a word. So if you tell me surrounding word of a word, I would like to predict what this word is going to be. If I don't get to see this word, but I get to see the words around that. In a skip gram, I'm trying to predict surrounding words if you give me one word. Okay, that's the difference between these two. Okay, we started with a continuous bag of word model. In continuous bag of word model, when we have context, which we show by C, and we would like to predict the word, which we show by W. So if you want to represent it as a network, then it would be a network of this form, basically a bottleneck. When that's the word that you want to predict, W, and that's your context. So we decided to simplify this model and consider the case that the context is only one word. So the input of the model is only one word. And then easily, when we are done with the derivation of this model, you can see that you can extend it to many words. So in this simplified version, the input is one word, which we call it context. And I want to predict the word which comes after that, which I call it W here. So it's a simple bottleneck. And there is no nonlinearity in this hidden space. So this I call X. And this hidden space, I will call it H. And the output, I call it Y. So the input is one hot representation of the word. So it comes in this form, a vector that is zero everywhere, except at one place. So all words that you have in your vocabulary, if you sort it out in any way, then one hot representation basically indexes the location of that word in this sequence. So this represents one single word. That would be the input of this model. Then we are going to have a hidden layer. So this is in RD. If we have D words, H would be a vector, which is basically simply a linear transformation of X by matrix W, which is my weight matrix. So H would be W transpose X. And since H is sparse and it is zero everywhere except in one position, then it's as if we are picking, when we multiply H by W, it's as if we are picking one row of W, which we call that row VC, means vector corresponding to context, okay? So same thing will happen here, except with another matrix W prime. So we have W prime transpose H, which generate a vector U. And again, this U, basically, if we look at one entry of this U, it's going to be one row of W prime, which we call it V W, vector corresponding to Word. To generate Y, we decided to apply a softmax to UI. Which, sorry, this is going to be V, VC transpose. So we decided to apply a softmax to this to make a probability out of this, which is going to be a function of this form. And then we have to normalize it, sum over all possible words. Okay. Capital W is weight matrix. Lowercase w is word. They have nothing to do with each other. Okay. So that was yi. And yi basically is probability of observing a word given a context. Now, if I want to compute VC and VW, I want to optimize this model, I need a cost function. And since this is a probability, my cost function could be maximum likelihood. So I can find the likelihood and basically maximize it. So for maximized likelihood calculation, you know, I have to define likelihood. So if I mean my parameters of this model is basically VC and VW, and then I define a likelihood function over these parameters, which is going to be a product of probability of W given C over all W's in the corpus. Okay. This P is basically parameterized by theta. And our goal is to find this theta. So this likelihood basically is going to be the product of E to the power of VC transpose VM divided by sigma E to the power of VC transpose VM over all V prime. Sorry, VW, not M. Over all W prime. I want to maximize this, and we got to this point in the last lecture. Is in any question or any ambiguity up to this point? Okay. So I want to maximize this likelihood. As usual, I can take a log of this and maximize the log likelihood. So the log likelihood of this model would be this product becomes summation over all words. The log of this quantity minus the log of this quantity, okay? So the log of this quantity is going to be VC transpose VW minus log of the summation. Okay. Now if I want to maximize this, I can take derivative with respect to my parameters. I have two parameters, C and W. I can take parameters with respect to each of them and set it to zero. Let's take derivative with respect to VW first. So if I want to take derivative with respect to VW, this is going to be VC, right? The first term, if I take derivative with respect to VW, it's going to be just VC. Then I have to take derivative of this log with respect to VW. So it's going to be minus 1 over this quantity. Okay. And then derivative of this quantity, which is going to be e to the power of VC transpose VW times VC. Okay. Now look at this part. What is this part? Sorry? It is the softmax, but it's in our model, it's this probability, right? This is basically this probability. So that's probability of W given C. So the derivative would be VC minus probability of W given C times VC, which is VC times 1 minus probability of W given C. I can do many things. For example, I can do gradient descent now to find VC, since I have the gradient. It's because there is no closed form solution. You know, if you set this to equal to 0, you can't find optimum VW in closed form. So you have to rely on a numerical method to solve this. So in this numerical method, for example, could be gradient descent. So if I want to apply gradient descent, then my new VW would be old VW minus gradient. And gradient is VC times 1 minus PW given C. Okay. So you can start with some random value for VC and VW, and then iterate until it converges. Okay, that's gradient descent. And if you look at this update function intuitively, it makes complete sense. You know, suppose that PW given C is a large number, means that I can predict the word given the context pretty well, perfectly. So if I'm perfect in predicting word given context, this is 1, right? And this is going to be 0, so this is going to be 0. So in this case, I'm not going to change VW. My algorithm converged. I'm done. When I'm done, when this is large, when I can predict the word given context perfectly. Okay, in this case, there's no any other iteration. But if this is a small, then I'm going to subtract a portion of VC from VM. Basically, I'm going to make these two vectors close to each other until it converges. You can do exactly the same thing for VC and find a function, iterative function. And if you want to extend this model to the case that you have many words in the context, the only thing that's going to be different is that the size of this matrix is going to be different. And in stuff 1 VC, basically you have a summation of a couple of VCs, VC1 plus VC2 plus VC3. But in practice, this is not useful in a sense that it's not practical. Do you know why? You know, let me tell you that if the corpus is really large, this iterative formula is not practical. You can't use it in practice. Have any idea why? Have in mind that in each iteration, I have to calculate this, right? Is there any part in this calculation which is computationally expensive? Yes?
Probability of W given C.
Probability of W given C is expensive to compute. Why it is expensive to compute? Exactly. You know, look at this denominator. Denominator is summation over all words. It means that in each iteration, you have to take the sum over all words. And don't forget that this corpus is huge corpus. You know, sometimes the size is almost the size of text in the internet. You know, it is, if you look at some of these data sets, it's huge. And then in each iteration, you have to take the summation. So it's not practical to apply this function on a large corpus. Okay, so if you have a small corpus, it makes sense. You can do it. But if you train it on a small corpus, then your result is not going to be something really fantastic. Okay, so we need another way. So that's another paper of Word2Vec, which basically introduced a skip-gram model and a concept which is called negative sampling. Okay. So in negative sampling, a skip-gram with negative sampling, basically, they turn this unsupervised learning problem to a supervised problem. This by itself could be a nice trick in many cases. You know, when you have an unsupervised problem, which is hard, using a technique similar to this trick that they are using, you can turn it to a supervised problem. But what the technique, what the trick is? Okay, so this is by far a completely unsupervised problem. I would like to find two vectors and don't have any labels. So I'm going to turn it to a supervised problem by this trick. I will define two sets, set D and set D prime. And set D is set of all pairs CW, or makes no difference, set of all pairs that are in the text. So you have a text in hand. If two words come together, they belong to set D. And I define D prime as set of all pairs that are not in the text. So if there are a pair of words that they don't appear together in this corpus, then I put them in set D prime. Now I define a new variable Z. It's like a label. Z is 1 if the pair is in set D, and 0 if the pair is in set D prime. So if this pair is in the corpus, then Z is 1. If this pair is not in the corpus means WC is in D prime, then it's zero. So Z is like a label. So my problem was unsupervised, I'm going to turn it to a classification problem. Suppose that I want to predict Z. I give you a pair, tell me it is in the corpus or it's not in the corpus. I'm going to learn a classifier based on the words that I've seen already and turn it to a classification problem that I want to predict. So probability that Z is equal to 1 given WC is the probability that WC is in D. And P Z equal to 0 given WC is the probability that W and C is in D prime. Okay, there are different ways actually to tackle this problem if you want to set it as a classification problem. You know, in general, in classification, our hope is to compute, you know, if you have an observation X and you have some labels Z, our hope is to find the posterior of Z given the observation, which is basically px given z times pz defined by px. Okay, in classification, usually we would like to compute this posterior. This is called class conditional, this is called prior, and this is marginal. So somehow we have to compute the class conditional and prior and the marginal. There are a couple of techniques in classification which basically try to compute this class conditionals and so on. And there are ways in classification that they try to model this posterior directly. So without modeling the class conditional, they try to model this posterior directly. And one of them is logistic regression. So logistic regression tries to model the posterior explicitly and directly. So the method that they are adopting here is pretty similar conceptually to logistic regression. That's not how they explain their model, but it is, in fact. Okay, so suppose that I want to model PZ given X. You know, I have PZ equal to 1, and my X here is this pair of words, okay? And I want to have a probability distribution function to model this. So I can define PZ equal 1 given WC as a logistic function. 1 divide by 1 plus e to the power of vc transpose vw. This is my choice, you know. I just chose this probability function to model pz equal to 1. So if I choose this function as pz equal to 1 given these words, then what would be the probability of Z equal to 0 given W and C. 1 minus this, the complement of this, right? So the complement of this would be e to the power of VC transpose VW divided by 1 plus e to the power of VC transpose VW. Right, this is the complement of this. If I add them up, it's equal to 1. To be consistent with the notation that they use in their paper, you can multiply this fraction by e to the power of minus WC transpose WT divided by e to the power of minus WC transpose W. Okay? See what I mean? Multiply this by e to the power of negative VC transpose VW divided by e to the power of negative VC transpose VW. Multiply it by 1. So it's going to be, this is going to be 1, and this is going to be 1 plus e to the power of negative VC transpose VW. So this is the complement of this, okay? Okay. Now, this is probability of Z being 1. This is probability of Z being 0. If I want to make probability of Z in general, given this pair, I can write it this way. I can write it as this probability to the power of Z times this probability to the power of 1 minus Z. See, if Z is equal to 1, then I pick only this term. This is 0. I mean, this is to the power of 0, which is 1. If Z is equal to 0, then this is 1, and I will pick only this part. So I sort of merge these two to one distribution function. Okay, this is basically my probability distribution, which is parameterized on theta when theta is, again, VC and VW. And now my goal is to find VC and VW. How do you find VC and VW? Maximum likelihood again, right? So I have the form of the probability. I have the form of distribution. It's parameterized on some theta. And given data, I would like to find proper parameters. I can do maximum likelihood. So I can define the likelihood of this function to be the product of basically this quantity and product over all pairs that are in D and in D prime. You know, all pairs that make Z equal to 1 and pairs that makes Z equal to 0 or all possible pairs. That's my likelihood. To maximize it, I can find the log likelihood of this, which is sigma over all possible words in D and D prime Z times log of 1 plus E V C transpose V W plus 1 minus Z log of 1 plus E to the power of minus V C transpose V W. Yes. Here? You know, I choose to represent PZ equal 1, probability of PZ equal 1, by this logistic function. If I choose to represent this by logistic function, probability of Z equal 0 is the complement of this. Means if I sum it with this one, it should be equal to 1. Okay, so that's going to be the complement of this, which has this form. So I have a function to represent probability of Z equal to 1. I have a function to represent the probability of Z equal to 0. I want to merge them in a way that one single function represents the probability of Z. This is a common trick that you can use, okay? Z is, I mean, I just multiply these two and power of 2 to the power of Z and power of 1 minus Z. So there are two possible cases. Either Z is equal to 1 or Z is equal to 0, right? If Z is equal to 1, this will be to the power of 1, right? And this will be to the power of 0. So this second part would be 1, and this part would be your function for Z equal 1. If Z is equal to 0, then this is to the power of 0. And this is to the power of 1, so you're going to have this function. Is that clear now? Any question? Then you form the likelihood, you take the derivative, it's log likelihood. Right, but how do you, you know, you have, you basically when you do maximum likelihood, you take the product of your probability over all observations. And you have two type of observations. Observations of pairs that are in D, observations of pairs that are in D prime. Pairs that comes in the corpus and make Z1, pairs that come that do not come in the corpus and make Z equal to 0, right? So my likelihood would be product over all observations. And my all observations are those pairs that are in D and those pairs that are in D prime. So union of them, all possible pairs, any pair, okay? I can simplify this more and write it this way. The like likelihood would be summation over, you know, if my pair is in D, then Z is equal to 1, right? So if I just sum over the pairs that are in D, Z is equal to 1. So Z is 1, I have this term, and Z is 1, I don't have this term, the second, right? So it is log of 1 over 1 plus E VC transpose VW. So if you consider the case that pair is in D prime, means that Z is equal to 0. If Z is equal to 0, then this term is 0. And this term is, this 1 minus Z is 1. So I have another summation here for pairs that are in D prime, log of 1 plus 1 plus E VC transpose VW. So basically, you can take this to two summations, summation over D and summation over D prime, and simplify your likelihood this way. Okay, I can take derivative of L with respect to my parameter, VC. And I can take derivative of L with respect to VW. It doesn't have closed form solution. I can't set it to 0, but I can compute this derivative. And then I can use, yes.
When we say VC there, that's like one specific vector, right? And then in the summation, VC is like, it's all of the possible Cs?
You're talking about this one?
Yeah. Would that be like VC prime and that's VC, or are these the same VC we're talking about?
This is basically, you know, VC and VW are both vector representation of words, but VC are representation of words as a context. W is representation of word as word, okay? And you're talking about all pairs, all contexts, and all words that are in D. So basically, both of them will change. None of them is fixed, you know? All possible pairs of C and W. And here, all possible pairs and C and W. But the difference is that these pairs are pairs that are not in the corpus. This is a pair of pairs that are in the corpus. Okay, this has a negative sign. Does it make sense? Okay. You know, this is pretty similar to logistic regression. In logistic regression, we compute the derivative, and we compute the second derivative, the Hessian, and we apply usually a Newton-Raphson method to solve. Okay, we can do something similar to that, or we can just compute the first derivative and apply something like gradient descent. Okay, the difference between this and logistic regression is that in logistic regression, you know, you want to find a classifier. And when you write your logistic function, it is 1 over 1 plus e to the power of some beta transpose x. X is your observation, and beta is your unknown, okay? This function is convex on beta. Here, actually, you have two variables, you know, VC and VW, as if this is unknown and this is unknown as well. So it's not convex over VC and VW, it's biconvex. I mean, given VC, you can compute VW in a convex form. Given VW, you can compute VC. So basically, it's an iteration that you initialize your value with some VC and VW, then iterate for VW, and then iterate for VC, and you alternate between them until it converges, okay? This is the objective function that you're going to see when you look at the original paper. Okay? I use the same notation in the original paper. You know, this is exactly the cost function that we derive here, with the exception that I did it for all words, all pairs, and what you see here is only for one pair. Okay? So, see, I had here for overall words. Suppose that I write the cost function for only one pair, then I don't have this summation and I don't have this summation, right? This is a logistic over, it's going to be you know, it's going to be logistic function of VC VW plus logistic function of negative VC VW for one pair. And that's this cost function. You know, they have different notations. So this is our VC, this is our VW. But they call it VWO and VWI, means VW means word, input word and output word. Okay? So input word would be context, output word would be word in our notation. And prime is VC, without prime is VW, okay? But I'm going to put the original paper, and so I use the notation of original paper for you to get familiar with the notation of that paper. Has very bad notation. It's pretty hard paper to read. You have to spend lots of time to understand actually what they mean by all of this, you know, everything has been explained intuitively, not mathematically. You know, there's no explanation of, you know, if you think we change the problem from unsupervised to supervised, so we end up solving an optimization problem which is totally different from the optimization problem that we start with. You know, it's a different problem. But you won't see this in the paper. You'll never say that we are solving a different problem now. You are starting with a problem, an optimization problem. You read the paper, and you are wondering that that was not the optimization problem they wanted to optimize. And then you have to read between line and realize that, okay, yeah, it's changing the problem to a supervised problem, changing the objective function. It's different problem now that we are solving. But it's good practice to read the original paper. So that's for one pair. With the exception that here, actually, you see, you know, this is logistic over WC transpose W, and there should be a negative sign here, which logistic over negative WC transpose W. But you couldn't see that here I have a summation, which I don't have it here in my derivation. Basically, what they do is that they say that in my cost function for one pair, when I come look at the probability of being a pair in the corpus, I look at the probability of couple of pairs not being in the corpus, not just one pair. You know, here is one pair, one pair. One pair in the corpus, one pair is not in the corpus. Okay? But in their cost function, there's summation here over k instances that are not in the corpus. Intuitively, it makes sense, right? Because the number of pairs that are not in the corpus is more than the number of pairs that are in the corpus. Right? Any two pairs, random pairs, possibly is not in the corpus, right? So as if you have a classification problem which is highly in balance. There are few number of points in this class compared to the other class. So in their cost function, when they consider the cost of one class, they cost a couple of pairs in another class. It's completely intuitive, you know, that they are doing this. And based on practice, not mathematics. Yes?
How do we iterate over the contexts? Seeing how context could be like a couple of words put together, do we have to iterate over all the possible combinations of words that make up a context?
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't that be like really, really large?
It is. It is really, really large, you know. And if you want to train Word2Vec on a very good computer, it takes maybe weeks to train. Yeah, it is computationally expensive. Okay, so pairs that are in the corpus is clear. You know, I have a text, I just look at all combination of the words in the corpus, and I do have it. What about pairs that are not in the corpus? I've never seen them, okay? So that's what the notion of negative sampling comes from. You know, they're sample from a distribution with the assumption that this word is not in the corpus. And how they do that, you know, for any single word, you can have 1 gram model. Okay, 1 gram model basically means that what's the probability of observing this word in the context? The single word in the context. It's pretty easy to compute, right? I have D words, I have N words, and I count the number of words that book appeared in this text, divide by the total number of words, that would be the probability of observing word book, right? So this is called 1 gram. 1 gram model. So I can have 1 gram model, which they call it PNW. PNW is 1 gram model for word W. Okay? So, PNW is number of times that word W has been observed, divide by total number of words. Okay. So suppose that I have 1 gram model, I know the probability of each word. I'm going to sample a word based on this probability, based on distribution, randomly. And I'm going to sample another word based on this distribution. And then I'm going to assume that this pair is not in the corpus. Okay? Because word has some structure, right? If you just draw a word randomly, most likely it's not a word that you're going to see in the corpus, you know. If you just choose two words randomly, most likely, I mean, the probability that it doesn't appear, you know, you're going to see that from later on, you're going to see that there are many, many heuristics involved in solving this problem. One of them is this one. So basically, we don't get to see the pairs that are not in the corpus, but what we are going to see is to just draw some W randomly, some C randomly, and assume that, okay, since it has been randomly selected, it's not in the corpus. Okay? Another heuristic is that instead of having only sigmoid over one, this pair, I'm going to add a couple of them. Select 5 of them. Another reason for this could be that if you select 10 words randomly, this is most likely, you know, a couple of them is not in the corpus. Okay? And this logistic function is just this logistic function that we had ordered. So is that clear? Okay, another heuristic actually here is that this P, which is 1 gram, unigram distribution of words, they are not going to sample from this p really. They are going to sample from p to the power of 3 over 4. So suppose that I have a vector of probability of each word, then take each of this probability to the power of 3 over 4. It's not a probability vector anymore because it doesn't sum to 1. Then normalize it, divide it by z to normalize. Now it's a probability vector. Now draw from this probability instead of p. Again, there is no explanation in the paper that why. But you can see intuitively that why you may want to do this, because in the corpus there are some rare words that appear, you know, very, very rarely. So if you want to sample from unigram, the chance that you sample from those words are quite small. You take this word to the power of 3 over 4, you give it more chance to be drawn. But why 3 over 4? God knows, you know. Because, I mean, they tried many different numbers, and it turned out that 3 over 4 works better. You know, they tried many numbers, and it turned out this one works better than others. And they chose this. So now everything else would be clear, that how we can do this. You know, we can basically do gradient descent, find VC and VW. But end of the day, you have set of vectors for context. You have set of vectors for word. Our goal was to basically project words in a vector space and represent each word by a vector. But I have two set of vectors now. A representation for the word when it comes as a context, a representation for the same, because a same word can be your context or can be your goal, right? But it's going to get two different representations. You know, the word book, if comes as the input of this vector, has a representation. If it's output of the vector, has a different representation. What can we do with this? Another heuristic. Just add these two vectors divided by 2. Or concatenate these two vectors. Different versions for them. Okay. You may ask that why we chose to have two different representations from the beginning. We could have make W equal to W prime, add more constraint to the network. Vector W is the same as vector W prime. And here I had VC transpose VC. I then have two variables. It was easier actually to solve. The problem was easier to solve. And end of the day, I had only one representation of the words. I didn't have two representations that I need to take average of them. Any idea that why might be useful to represent these two different vectors at the beginning and then take the average of them rather than choosing one representation from the beginning? Sure.
The word and context. The word can be longer than the context too, right? The word can be 3 words or 5 words. It doesn't really matter, right? And the context can be higher than 3 or 1 in the beginning or at the end of the text.
Right. I mean, the whole context would be a combination of 5 words. But for each of them, you find a vector representation. It's not a representation for all of these 5, you know? If you extend that model that we had here, this bottleneck, instead of 1 word, you have like 5 words, the difference would be that you're going to have a summation over 5 WC, It's not a WC, which is a VC, sorry. It's not a VC, which is a representation of five words. You know, still you have representation of each word, but you have summation of five of them, for example, as your rate to the input of the vector, the network. Yes?
For the context and word representation, is it because words have different meaning depending on like their order, so this would capture that better than just taking words as, like if I have a word after something, it's different than a word before something,
but I'm not sure if this captures it because this is a dot product, right? VC transpose VC. If I write it VW transpose VC, it would be the same. It doesn't capture this order. Again, maybe a reason, you know, this is also not in the paper. There's no explanation, but maybe one reason actually to model it this way is that it's pretty rare or almost not possible that a word comes after itself, right? So in a text, rarely it appears, or never it appears, that a word comes after itself. You know, we don't have this pair. But suppose that these two vectors are the same. If these two vectors are the same, how can you maximize e to the power of vc transpose vc? It's going to be maximized when these two VC are the same, right? So it's going to assign a high probability to the case that a word comes after itself. There's no way to avoid that. But it's really pretty rare case. You don't want this to happen. So if you have chosen logistic function to be representative of your probability, then if you have e to the power of vc transpose vc, then for the case that these two words are the same, it's going to get the maximum value. But you don't want this to happen because it's a rare case. You don't want to assign a high probability to this case. So one way to get around this is to, in modeling, you assume that these are two different vectors. Okay? Okay, let me show you some of, I showed you a couple of examples of this model before. It performs really well in practice, and it's a state of the art. It's a state of the art for word representation now. There are many implementation of that. In practice, you don't need to you don't need to compute it because the computation takes weeks, you know. There are dictionaries of words in different languages. Google has a dictionary, for example, that given a word, you can look at this dictionary and see what the word representation is. I showed you a couple of examples that king and queen and man and woman and so on. These are some other examples. Relation between, for example, Chicago and Illinois is the relation between Houston and Texas. So if you look at the distance between Chicago and Illinois is the same as distance between Houston and Texas. Let's take, this is also true for a country and the capital of the country. The distance between capital of a country and the name of the country for different countries are the same. You know, Paris to France has the same distance of Ottawa to Canada. So somehow you can infer, you know, this relation between words. Which order?
The order of words we put in a vector. Like, the first word of the vector should be this specific word?
No, no. No, you have a dictionary that given this word, this is the vector representation. Given this word, this is the vector representation. You have a text, any text. For any word in your text, you know what the vector representation is. Okay. Yes?
The data challenge, would we be allowed to use that embedding?
Oh, sure. I mean, for data challenge, you're allowed to use anything.
Okay. But I thought there was like the constraint usually, like, don't use outside of the data set you're provided. If we were to use like something, let's say an embedding that Google already has ready for you, and then we use that to kind of do like our intent parsing.
No, you can use the embedding that Google has. I mean, that dictionary, or there are different packages that help you to assign, you know, these words. In Python, there are packages that you can use that, given this text, it gives you vector representation for each of them. You can use those.
Okay.
No problem. But for classification, you have to use only logistic regression at the end. You can change the classifier.
Right.
But rather than that, you can do anything.
Okay.
And now, good that you remind me, you know, in data challenge, you have different sentences. How are you going to represent these sentences? You know, one way to represent a sentence is word frequency. And word frequency, I told you, this is set of words and set of documents. In your data challenge, for example, it's one document, one of the reviews that has been written for book. This is another review that has been written for book, and so on. And these are set of all words. Word frequency representation means that these words appear 5 times, these words appear 10 times, and these words didn't appear in the text. So this vector will be a representation of this review. And this vector would be a representation of this review. So I'm going to feed a classifier with these vectors, okay? That would be word frequency. If you think of word frequency, basically it means that I represented each word as one hot vector, and then I add them up, right? There was word book here, and in my corpus, I represented book as one hot, zero everywhere. And word book appeared again, so 100, and appeared again and again, and then I add them up, it means that 5 times word book appeared in the text. So word frequency basically means each sentence is summation of all one hot representation. So you can represent each text now. I mean, that would be one option, you know, in your data challenge. You can simply, and there are packages to do it. You don't need to write the code for this. You know, there are many packages in many different languages that you can use. Given the text, it gives you word frequency matrix. And by the way, there are some links in Piazza that gives you some tutorial sort of material of how you handle text data. This is raw word frequency, and usually in text mining, there are other things applied to this. You know, there are words that appear frequently, but that they are not representative. For example, like articles, A, D, you know, it's in each text you have A. In each text you have D. It's not representative. You know, the fact that D is appeared many times here doesn't tell you anything about this text being positive or being negative, because it appears everywhere. It's not a representative feature. So these are called a stop word. You know, many of these packages that are going to use, automatically they are going to remove a stop words from the representation. There are some normalization in involved that you can use those, and these are built in all of these packages. But another way to represent this is to, instead of one hot, choose Word2Vec representation for each word and then add them up. You know, that would be another way to represent a sentence. That's not the best way, actually, to represent a sentence, though. None of these two. You know, there are other ways that you may choose or you may not choose to represent the text that way. Some of them might be quite complicated compared, I mean, to the materials that you have seen. You have to use like LSTM networks and so on to represent the words. But it's not necessary for your data challenge. If you want to do so, you are welcome to do. But if you don't choose to use those complicated techniques to represent the sentence, still you're going to be above threshold. You know, you can get the full mark or good mark. Still, you're going to be above the threshold. But you can choose, you know, to represent the sentence in a better way. Another way, actually, to represent the sentence is to put all of these Word2Vec or one-hot representations together and make a matrix out of that. So your sentence or your review would be a matrix, not a vector. And then there are methods like convolutional neural network and so on that can be applied on this network. I'm just telling you that there are many techniques in the literature, in the packages that you're going to see for text mining. But to get the good mark in this data challenge, you don't need to know those. You just need to know the materials that you learn in this course, including Word2Vec. So this type of relation you can find between like a company and the CEO of the company, for example, you know, and a team and the coach of the team. Also, you can find semantic relation. The relation between bad and worst is the same as relation between big and biggest in terms of distance of these vectors, or great and greatest. Or the relation, the distance between dancing and danced is the same as, say, for example, falling and fell, you know, past tense and... Okay, any question here? Yes. No, this is basically a representation of how good my this is going to be an illustration of how good my representation of words are. That's not setting up our problem, you know. We are just showing that this representation of word captures semantic meaning, captures grammar. So it's basically an illustration that it can be quite useful in natural language processing. You have a representation of words that distance between past and present of all words are the same. ING forms and simple words of all words are the same, you know? And some facts like capitals and countries are the same. So you can come up with any problem that you like, but it basically, it's not that, you know, this network solved this problem, given this word, give you the ING form, no. But knowing that there are these distances between vectors, you can define your problem the way that you like.
So in the capital country example, it needs to come across both capitals in both countries in the...
Yeah, the corpus that, for example, Word2Vec in Google Dictionary, Word2Vec is trained on, is almost the whole internet. You know, everything is there. All words are there. All names, all verbs, all everything. All name of countries, name of cities. It's a huge corpus. Any question? So there are a couple of other things that I want to tell you about Word2Vec, but I will leave it for the next lecture so your assignment is ready. I'm just going to return this assignment.